Well, that was like a sudden quiet down there. I might have to look. I didn't give you the look, though, you know, the mother look, the grandmother look now. Although a grandmother's look is not near as stern as the mother look. So if you don't know who I am, my name is Lottie Gardner, and yes, I am married to this lovely man. Have been for a very long time, but not long enough. I want more. It's been good. And we've been here, as you know, a very long time as well. I keep on forgetting, 36. It's been 30. Yeah, but sorry, it's been 36 years. Yes. And so it's been 36 years, and our daughter, our oldest daughter, always hates us talking about that because we always said that, you know, like she was 6 weeks old when we came here. So everybody's like, thanks, Mom. Everybody knows my age. It's like, yeah, what? Sorry, but you're only 36, you know. It's not like that's that hard. Anyways, but so this morning, as you know, in the summertime, we are talking about our values as a church. We all have values, and a lot of times, you know, when we get married, we need to talk about what our values are, and we don't even know how to express or what our value is until somebody kind of smacks at it or offends us or does something against our value. Then we go, oh, that must be a value of mine, or you're starting to think about it. It's like, oh, I guess that is a value. And these are the kind of things you need to discover. Well, we're going to be talking about this. These values have been around for a long time, since we've been here, like I said, 36 years. And so we want to go over that as we were talking about it at our elders and our staff, that it's like, hey, if we have these values, we don't communicate them, then really what good are they? Are they values? And sometimes you just, you know, they just are by what we do and how we act. But it's like we want to know why we do what we do, what we do, and where is it grounded in Scripture and why. So what would you just pray for me, let's just pray right now as we come into God's Word. Lord God, I pray, Lord, as we talk about this value today, Lord God, that and we read your Word, that you would, this isn't something man made up and we're making up things along the way. This is grounded in your Scripture and what we believe you are saying and called us to do and to be. And so, Lord God, would you reveal what you want to reveal to each of us today in your name, God. Amen. Amen. So who we are? Well, for one of this value today that we're talking about is about restoration and wholeness for everyone. Now, this is what we believe, and this is a value. It's for everyone. And have you ever tried to restore anything? I don't know about you, Lou. If you've, you know, sometimes I've had china cups that get broken, and you can get out that fine china glue, and you put it together, and you hold it, and you hold it, and you hold it, and you let it go, and it just falls apart again. Then you hold it and hold it, and then finally you get out that glue gun. It's like, this sucker is going to stay together. Well, then really it isn't. Like, I don't know about you, but that's not what I call restored, right? Probably when I get out the glue gun, I'm not restoring anything. I'm just making sure it sticks together. Well, when God is restoring something, it is totally different. It is totally different. So, you know, again, if you've tried to restore clothing, you know, again, I can sometimes, you know, I can sew, but there's things like I don't darn socks, and I think those darn socks have gone. I don't know if, does anybody have that skill? Do you? Good job. I have some old darner bobble things, and if you want them, I could talk to you. I don't know what you even know. There, if you ever see anything at a antique show and it's like this hard ball and it has almost look like a mallet that you're going to squish something, those are for darning. And that's what it is. So good. Anyways, woo, way off there. I am not ADHD, by the way. I'm not. But I might appear to be so, but no. It's called scatterbrain. And some people would call it blonde. This is real. So, you know. Anyways, but if you don't do our restoration well, sometimes it's not even usable because you can't hot glue a mug and put its handle on, because what will happen when you put hot drink in a mug that had been repaired with hot glue? It'll fall apart. You don't want to do that. So when sometimes we try to fix, we try to restore, we try to make something whole, and it is really not useful. It is not repaired. It has not been restored. I read a wonderful quote, and it says this: God just doesn't treat us; He heals us. I read that. I thought, wow, that is so profound. That God isn't just treating us. He doesn't just sometimes you can treat a patient, but God heals us right from the inside out. And when he restores it, there is no, we don't have to get a magnifying glass and go, there was a crack here, but I see it's been restored. When we look, it's like, it's perfect. There's been nothing wrong with it. Sometimes there might be still a scar there in our lives, but God, when he restores, it's perfect. So this morning is the story and the message of God's word. And the word, of course, is the Bible. This is where we get our inspiration. This is where we get it. Everything we teach has to be grounded in the word. The story of man started, and I put my Bible back here, started right in Genesis. And in my Bible reading, I went back to Genesis, and I, you know, you're reading along, and it's a lovely story of creation, obviously, if you've read it. It says God created, and it was beautiful. And he would say, yeah, I created this, and it was beautiful. God is a creative God. And when he did it, it was like he created perfection, and it was beautiful. The story of man was a story about relationship with God, that God said he created man and women in his image. And then we would come to the garden, he would walk with them. I don't know in what form God came down, but all I know is it says that. And of course, it was written many years later, and they realized, hey, we'd better start writing these things down so that we can pass this on more accurately. And God inspired those who were writing these truths down. It says that God walked with them in the garden. So right away, we see that God created us whole. We didn't need to be restored because there was perfection there, and he walked among us. God created us to have relationship with him. Genesis 1:27 says this, so God created man in his own image, male and female, he created them. And you know what? We were created like God with a choice. God chose to create man. God had a choice to create us. He made us in his image, and so therefore he gave us a choice. Well, what did that choice do? What happened with that choice? Well, sin entered the world because man, Eve, Adam, chose to believe in the serpent and not in God. God said, you can have everything, but don't have this. I know, you know, some of you wonder, well, why did God create this? Why did he create them with a choice to sin? Like, yeah, we can have a choice, but if he had gotten rid of that whole tree, well, then maybe we wouldn't have sinned. I don't know. I'm not God. I don't know why he created. All I know that there was a knowledge of good and evil, and God says, I don't want you to take this. This isn't going to be good for you. And have you ever said to a child, you can have everything, but don't touch this? What do they want? What do you see when you come into a room? You see that. Like, don't think of an elephant. What do you think of? An elephant. I guess it should be a don't think of a pink elephant or a white elephant. But and now, woo, you have all those colors in there. But God, in Genesis 3, then it said we made a choice and a sin entered the world. The relationship that we had with God was broken. So right away, it didn't take long. And so you're reading, and it's coming along lovely, and in chapter 3, page 3, basically, of this book that, depending on your Bible, is up to 2,000 pages. Basically, at page 3, it all went, I don't use this profanely, but went to hell in the handbasket, right? I mean, it literally did. It was just like, well, there goes the world that God created. Men are saying, like, what, you know, we have to take care of this earth. And it's like, well, finally they're waking up and realizing that, hey, if we don't do something, this, you know, they're trying to prevent the inevitable from happening. And God already set the end of the world in a time. He already said this world is coming to an end. And we don't, you know, and we're all frantic about saving it. No, what we need to be frantic about is getting people into having a relationship with the Lord. Because this planet is going to end. It is not. It has not been here for billions of years. Sorry to blow that theory, but it hasn't. And God said he created this world, and he created it in perfection. And then in page 3 of this book, boom, it all went to pot. And so I shouldn't use that word anymore either. Because pot is bad, children. That's right. It was just destroyed. And you know what? One of the verses then I was reading, it said that God was so, this is to me one of the saddest verses of the Bible. It was in Genesis 6, verse 6. It says this, it says that God was sorry that he made man. It says his heart was filled with pain. So right from, again, page 3 on, relationship was broken. But then, it wasn't filled with hopelessness, this book. It's all about, and you read through the Old Testament, it's important, you know, if you're a new Christian, yes, read the New Testament over and over and over again, and then read the Psalms, but then eventually go to Genesis and read through the story of the restoration process that God has put into us. And it's all about man doing things wrong and leaving the Lord and forgetting about God, and then God reaching out down and saying, I'm going to destroy you, and then God's like, yeah, but what if there's five people? What if there's five people that are worthy, Lord? That's the story of Lot. What if there's five? What if there's 10? And God says, okay, I won't destroy. I will save you. Well, God will always save us if we cry out to him. He will always restore if we call out to him. He will always restore relationship. It's about God reaching down to us, always forgiving when we ask for forgiveness and humbling ourselves when we return to him. It's the story. This whole book is the story of restoration and wholeness, of God restoring relationship with him. It is why Jesus came. It is why we exist today. And because sin entered our world, our lives, we need to restore. We need Jesus to restore us to wholeness again. Because we believe, and here's this slide, in restoration and wholeness for everyone. That is a really important part for everyone. And as we see our world coming together, we just have to open our door and see everyone. The cultures are just all around us, and it's good. It says, we will be a place of spiritual, emotional, and physical safety where love, acceptance, and forgiveness are always demonstrated. It says, what kind of a church does this look like? Well, I want to tell you two stories of people that have moved on from here, but stories of past. And I'm changing names just for privacy's sake. But I'm going to tell you the story of Henry. And Henry came from a home where his mom was a Christian, but his dad was not a Christian. But both were alcoholics. Henry was an alcoholic. His brother was an alcoholic. His sister was an alcoholic. His mother was an alcoholic, and his dad was an alcoholic. But Henry came to know the Lord, and he struggled with relationships and with God and with others, and he struggled with alcoholism. But we just loved on Henry and accepted him where he was. We encouraged him to take steps towards wholeness. We came alongside him as he learned how to walk in righteousness and how to live a life without relying on alcohol, learning how to rely on God for strength. We could not change Henry, but God could. We provided an environment, a space, a support of love, acceptance, and forgiveness when needed. Today, Henry continues to serve the Lord and became a leader in a church. Now, the story of Stella. Stella came from an unchurched background, but someone invited Stella to a youth group. So she was young. I think she was about 16 when Stella came to us. And she lived in a non-Christian home. She grew up without knowing the Lord. But it wasn't long before Stella came to the church, and she came here and she gave her heart to the Lord. And she wanted God to totally take over her life, and he did. And he restored her to the person that she was created to be. She became loving, joyful, caring, and she caught the eye of a young pastor. And but she didn't feel worthy or good enough to marry a pastor, because to be in the ministry, she felt that she needed to not have gone through what she did as she had chosen as a young adult. So Stella asked God to give her a pure heart once again to restore her innocence. And well, because Stella allowed the Holy Spirit to fill her, that's exactly what happened. And Stella married the young pastor. Only God can restore us to the person he created us to be free of guilt and condemnation, and to make us pure as snow again. This is the kind of church that we have been and want to be. Galatians 6:1 says this, brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, You who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently, but watch yourself, or you may also be tempted. This verse, when it says brothers and sisters, so that is implying right there that you're in relationship, right? When you say brothers and sisters, if someone, one of you who call yourselves a family, and that's what we call ourselves as church family, it says one, if one of you is caught in sin, you who live by the Spirit. So again, we sung this morning where the Spirit of the Lord, there is freedom. So it is again, this verse is saying, if you're living by the Spirit and you have relationship and someone has chosen poorly, that we need to try and restore that person. What does it say? Gently. Gently to restore a person. That again, if you take a heavy hand to someone, and if we beat someone up for choices that we have made, if we are harsh with them, then it's not by the Spirit, because the Spirit, the freedom is not harsh. The Spirit of the Lord is not condemnation. The Spirit of the Lord is gentle. And it says that. It says, but watch yourself, or you may also be tempted. There's nothing worse than a double drowning. And I barely know how to swim, but this is what I struggle with. Okay, this is a commercial break. As I think, you're right, there can't be a double drowning. But you got to believe, if there's my grandchild in there, I'm going in. Do you know what I'm saying? But as a trained lifeguard, nothing worse than a double drowning. But you know what I think about that? And I think, Lord, if that's one of my kids, one of my grandkids, somebody I know in there, you're going to do everything you can. And that's where we might not be able to go in, but the God can. That's where we trust in the Lord. And it says, but watch yourself or you may be tempted. And that double drowning could mean totally different thing. This person, when I talked about Henry, see Henry, what Henry didn't need somebody to go to the bars with him and says, let's go to the bar together and we'll drown our sorrows, Henry. It'll be okay. See, Henry didn't need that. He needed somebody who was sober around him and to say, what are you doing? Smack, smack, don't you go to the bar again? That's the worst place for you. Like, get rid of the alcohol in your home. You don't need that. It says, restore them gently, but watch yourself. Watch yourself. It can't be done in our own strength. It has to be done by the power of the Spirit. It says, again, who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. If we try to do it in our own strength, that is not going to be healed properly. The restoration isn't going to be healed. Reaching out to the person is not going to be done properly. Be careful. You have to take care of yourself as well. A church... Next slide says, a church that is a place of spiritual, emotional, and physical safety. We read that in the second slide. We talked about what kind of church we want to be, and this is a value of ours, that our church is supposed to be a place of spiritual, emotional, and physical safety. You know, Judy Jones and I have the privilege. We pray. It started when we expected our first grandchild 12 years ago. It's her birthday tomorrow, Audrey. And when we found out we were going to be grandparents together, that we had this grandchild growing, we said, let's get together and let's start praying. And we started praying, and we continue to do that even when we don't have grandchildren, for our own. We started praying for those that in our church that did desire that. And this is one thing that we pray over them, is to have spiritual, emotional, and physical safety. We pray that our young would come to the Lord at a young age. We pray that nothing, no harm would come. And this is where what's hard. Because this is where every person wants that for their child. Every person, I want that for every person here. But I know that this place and others around the world have been hurt here. And in other places. I was just with somebody last night. They were talking about their brother, and they grew up in Africa. And the youngest child, they had the chance to send their youngest child to a boarding school of friends that they knew, of Christian friends. And they sent them to boarding school where he was greatly abused. And every year they would send him back, and every year he pleaded and said, I don't want to go back there. And it's like, oh no. They thought that was a place of safety. Emotional and physical safety. The guilt that is on those parents is huge. This child is in their 50s, but the trauma has happened. But I know that that's why when I was thinking about this message, and I know there's been trauma caused by people in our church, past leaders who we thought were safe, who weren't. You can't know the guilt, responsibility as shepherds we feel. It's like, why didn't we protect our sheep? We, as grand, like again, as parents, as grandparents, we can't go around. As our children are running around, we can't go and put bumpers around them, you know, and protect them from every owie that they're going to get. All that we can do is put safety in place, and that's why if you see our ushers walking up and down the aisle, the halls on a Sunday morning, it's to let others know that we're walking through here and that just to make sure that nobody's where they shouldn't be. We do crim checks on everybody who is in the back. But there's no guarantees, people. There's no guarantees. So when we say that we are a church of spiritual, emotional, and physical safety, we know that people have been hurt. But we also know that God can restore and give wholeness. There's friendships that have been broken. There is relationships that have been broken. And, you know, all I know is that our hope is in the Lord. And we can sing it as well with my soul. And that God wants to restore. And there's people who have left here. And again, relationship has been broken. And when they come to mind, I pray for them and I say, Lord, may they get wholeness wherever they're going. May they go to a church that will provide wholeness. Because sometimes when there has been hurt in a church, you can't always be restored in the place where hurt has happened, especially if you've caused hurt. It's not healthy for the people who have been wounded. So sometimes the best thing for those people, like we can say, well, I thought you were a church that, you know, love accepts and forgives. Yes, but in protection, sometimes we have to say that this isn't the best place that you're going to be restored and healed. And we have to protect. We have to protect those the lives who have been broken here. And so we're going to move in and we're going to lovingly and you go and gently and say by the Spirit, you say, Lord God, if there's another place, let them go to someplace they can get restored and whole. There's been people that have come here and had marriage failures in their marriage and had made choices, but they wanted restoration, so they've come here to the church, and because they couldn't stay where they were, there was too many people that knew their story and too many things that had gone on, but they've come here, and we were able to be a part of that restoration and the wholeness and the healing. You see, there's no wrong or right place to do it. If sometimes people come here and we provide that because it wasn't safe or too many people, it was hard to be restored there. So they come here, they get whole, and then maybe they go somewhere else. We've had people who've had teenage pregnancies, and it's like, Lord, they will come and the Lord will just guide them through that. People have made choices and we'll say, you know what, you need to step down from ministry for a while. Let God heal whatever's going on in your life. That's what a church of wholeness and restoration looks like. So how does God want us to respond? Well, first of all, we do whatever it takes to stop the hurting. If we know if there is a hurting going on, we'll do whatever it takes to protect and to make that stop. Sometimes it's confrontation. Sometimes it's removing a leader, but we're going to do whatever it takes. So restoration and wholeness is for everyone. It's those who have been hurt, but it's also for those who have hurted others. I was thinking about this as I was putting this together. I thought, well, what if I'm sitting here and I know I've caused hurt to someone, I have abused someone, or I've caused other hurt. We don't have to physically abuse someone to cause hurt. Well, what if I'm the one that has caused that hurt? God, see, it's not only for the hurting. But I would say also those who hurt are also hurting. But I mean, God restores both sides. And I don't know your story, and nor do we need to. There's things that we don't always need to know, what you've gone through, or the hurt that you've caused someone else. If you're wanting to say, Lord, I don't want to do that anymore, maybe it was in your past. Again, we don't need to know everything. But God can give wholeness and restoration, and there can be wellness for those who have caused hurt as well. And that's what we believe, that we are going to be this kind of a church of love, acceptance, and forgiveness, and it has to be real. This is getting real this morning, folks. In Romans, and I have to get another tissue. I was thinking of this morning, I was getting teary-eyed in the shower, and I thought, I better put waterproof mascara on this morning, and I did. But nothing is not fallible. Anyways, so Romans 12, 17 to 19. Why don't you turn with us there? Romans 12, 17 to 19. Romans 12, 17. And I'm using NIV this morning. It says this: do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it is mine to avenge, and I will repay, says the Lord. I will repay, says the Lord. We're only responsible for our part. It says to be careful to do what is right. So again, it is up to us. We have to take responsibility on our part to do what is right in everyone's sight. And again, I mean, I'm human. If you live with somebody, you're not going to do everything right. Even if we live by ourselves, in my own mind, in my own car, I can get into trouble about thinking the wrong thing or interpreting somebody's action the wrong way. You can get offended easily. It's like, oh, that offends me. It's like, well, they don't even know you, you know, and that offends you. I think we say that a little bit too much nowadays. We're taking offense at the things that maybe that we're not supposed to, but it says, if it possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. That's a big thing. Live at peace with everyone. It's like, really, everyone, God? Really, everyone? I like these people. Like, this is not a problem here. I like this. This is easy. But it says, oh, live at peace with everyone. I wish that wasn't there. And then it says, do not. It just does. It just does. And then it says, do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. I think that that's one of the easiest things that we want to do is when we get hurt, we want to hurt back. Have you ever seen two cats or two kids? Meow, meow. It's like, you did this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to yell faster, I'm going to yell louder, I'm going to scream louder, I'm going to get back at you, you did this, blah, blah, blah. And you try to, separate kids that have been fighting, it's this little ball of yarn there, and you know, like maybe we're more sophisticated as that, but somebody does something, and I think, I mean, like, again, you've heard me talk about driving, like, it is a sport, right? And if somebody, my husband, God bless that man, he just goes into la la land, and it's his time to just think. And me, it's like, no, I can't let that person in front of me. I can't do this. And I'm just like, oh, you know, I get so upset. And I want, it's like, well, they cut me off. I'm going to cut them off. And then God says, like, really? Does it, like, really, you want to be that kind of a person? They don't know you. And I'm serious. This is me right here. It is not personal. They don't know you. They do not say, I'm going to cut, that's Lottie Gardner, and I'm going to cut her off. It's not personal, right? But what if it is personal and we hurt the very people that we care about? I know, I'm sorry. I'm getting better, though. I'm sorry. But what about when it is personal? It says for God to say, don't be vengeful, don't be wrathful. God will take care of them. Eventually, he'll take care of them. And by saying that, we do not ever say, go to hell. Don't ever say that. We say it flippant. we say it without thought. We say it without really saying what we're saying. Are you really saying to never know the love of God? To get out of my face. I don't want to ever see you. I want you to go to hell. Those are powerful words. And we say, whether we say it flippantly or we say that because we mean it, it says, God says, that's up to me. If somebody's going to go to hell, it's through Jesus' blood and his body. I believe at the very last second, the very most vilest person on earth is going to get a chance to say to God, I am sorry. Forgive me. I want you. I have to believe that God died for every single person. And we don't ever want to say to anybody, that's where you should go. You need to fry for your rest of your life. Be separated from the love of God. So when we you know, sometimes we walk on the street and we see the unlovely, and I just think, God died for that person. God died for that person. He saved that person. May that person be with me in heaven. May that person be saved. And we need to pray that every person that comes in contact with the Lord would be saved. We need to pray that if it's me that's to tell them about the love of God, that we do that. Take responsible, be careful. I think this is a daily prayer of ours. Daily prayer to do what is right. It says, be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. Oh, goodness, to be doing the right eyes, of, that to do what's right in front of every person is a challenge of our life because we have sin. And, you know, and I think some people are more saintly. Like Tom's mother, like she was pretty up close up there. But every once in a while, you would hear her say something that wasn't 100% nice. It was like 98.9%, you know. But she would get ticked off every once in a while. God bless that little woman. But you know, she was one of the most saintly and godly women I know. And so I know that we can become more like the Lord. And my mother always had a statement. Both of our moms, you know, they are, my mom's living and we miss her being here, but she's going to the church at Elim with my dad. But my mom would always say, all the time, if you want to be a sweet old lady, you got to be a sweet young lady. That we don't just become sweet when we're old. If we're not sweet now, you've met them, right? Cranky. You can get cranky as you get old. You can get less patience as you get old, especially if you live by yourself or, you know, just, you know, when it's just Tom and I, it's like, it's not hard to live because most of the time I'm home by myself and it's like, it's a pretty happy, peaceful place. But then you get more people in the house as we do right now and it's like, oh, you know, you have to work at relationship and you have to forgive and be kind to one another. So anyways, human nature wants to give to get what we receive, but God says he will repay. Only God is holy enough to do this. We can't do that. What's our part? In Luke 6:27, it says this. But to you who are listening, I say this, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. I mean, if that doesn't cover every sin that we think is held against us, if that doesn't cover it, I don't know. What does it say? But to you who are listening, so you could plug your ears if you want and not read the Bible, but this is what it says. Love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. I know in a room this size that there are those who have been abused emotionally, sexually, physically, even by somebody not taking care of you as it can be a form of abuse. And I know what it's like to go through abuse, and I know what it's like to not feel a lot of love towards that person and to want to separate yourself, and I did. But I also know that God said you have to forgive. And as far as it is up to me, I have to forgive, and I have to move on. And you have to not allow that hurt to come back and to hurt you once more. That you've got to allow that Lord, the Lord, to come into your life. And it says again, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, and bless those who curse you, and pray for those who mistreat you. And unfortunately, a lot of times we are mistreated and we are abused by those who are supposed to be taking care of us. That's the sad thing. It's by those that we are supposed to be loving us. So we, it says, when we talk about our church here and what a value is, it says we will be a place of love, acceptance, and forgiveness. This is the kind of environment that we can we can be restored in, where we can be made whole. This is an environment where we rely on the Holy Spirit to help us when we are weak, to love when it is difficult, not just when they are cute puppies and babies, right? I mean, who doesn't love a cute puppy? Well, I don't really love them. Yes, I do. I do love them. They are cute. I just don't want them coming and living in my house. But the cute. But who doesn't love a baby, right? I mean, again, maybe some of you don't. But I, you know, it's. It says to love when it is difficult. Not just when it's easy. Not when it's cute. Not when they're just giving you ice cream and chocolate, because eventually that's not love, right? Just giving somebody all the sweets they want, that's not love. They need your vegetables, they need your milk, well, or, you know, oat milk. But you need, that we need nourishment, and sometimes love will look different. It's like I said, you know, as grandparents, you want to just spoil your grandkids. But when you have, like we have the young boys, twice a week, and so we become custodial grandkids, parents, that we have to take care of them. They have to have naps, and no, they can't just have sweets all day, because you're taking care of them, and eventually you have to use the word no, right? Even to sweet little grandkids. Sometimes it's easy, but other times it's not. And so, but when life is difficult, we're going to love, acceptance, and forgive. Because when it's easy, we can do that. But when love gets difficult, and when whatever relationship you're in, if love has become hard, God can restore that. When we say that God is the God of restoration and wholeness for everyone, we say that God will restore us. He will restore relationships as long as both parties agree and come together. I'm talking specifically now about friends or about spouses if you're married and life has become difficult. I know that God can restore. He can restore brokenness. He can restore when there has been trust has been broken, that he will love, if we love, acceptance, and forgive one another, he will bring wholeness and restoration. 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says this, "Now may the God of peace make you holy in every way, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless until our Lord Jesus Christ comes again." This is the promise of wholeness for us. It says, make you holy in every way. That's what we want to become. That is our goal. And make your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless until our Lord Jesus Christ comes again. This is a hope. We're not there yet, but this is a hope that this can happen. This is what we should be striving for. That, yes, there is pages and pages and pages, especially in the Old Testament, of broken relationship. But in the promises when Jesus came, he says, I am a God of peace and I will make you holy. In every way, I will make you holy in your body, soul, and spirit. Actually, it's spirit, soul, and body, because it's our spirit that he wants to touch. And when he touches our soul, then our spirit and our body come in alignment when he touches our soul. And it says, until Jesus comes again or until we go to be with him. We sang that beautiful song, "Come As You Are." The Spirit of the Lord is here to heal. The Spirit of the Lord is here to forgive, whether you need to forgive someone or ask God to forgive you. The Spirit of the Lord is here to help you forgive. And I'm going to leave you with one last scripture. Would our worship team come up? One last scripture, and we sang this today, and you know, it's nice to know, where do our songs come from? A lot of them come right from God's Word. We sang 2 Corinthians 3:17 this morning. It says, "For the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord, there is freedom." We are being transformed into his holy image with ever increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Would you bow your heads this morning as the worship team plays? Would you just allow, I don't know what God is saying to you, but he wants to heal you, body, soul, and spirit this morning. Would you allow him to talk to you? And I don't, we're not into drugging up old hurts. If you have let something go, don't bring it back up and feel that hurt again. But just allow the Lord to reveal what he wants to reveal to you this morning. Says, lay down your hurt. If there's anyone here that you just say, Lottie, would you just pray for me? I need to lay down my hurt. Would you raise your hand? I'd love to pray for you. Is there anybody like that? Okay. Anybody else? Yeah. Okay. Anybody else? God, I just pray for all those that raise their hands. Lord, it says that we are not holy enough. Only you are holy enough to deal with those who have hurt us, Lord God, and that you will repay the evil that is not up to us. And Lord, I pray for however each person here has been hurt. Lord, you know their situation. I ask, God, I pray for freedom in your name. Lord, I pray for freedom to come where the Spirit of the Lord is, and your Spirit is here to bring freedom. Lord, that's what I pray for, freedom, for wholeness right now. Lord, I pray, Lord God, that the unforgiveness, will be just broken right now, that you would just blast that out of them, Lord God, this knot in their stomach, the control that the enemy has over them, of the power of unforgiveness and hurt. Lord God, Holy Spirit, would you just come and burst that forth, Lord God, and we just pray that it would be made whole, that you've come to heal, not to treat us, but to heal us this morning. So, Lord, I pray for your wholeness right now in our lives, Lord God. You just touch them. Now, if you have caused, if the Lord is saying to you, you've hurt somebody, you've not asked forgiveness of the Lord, and he is here to forgive you. If you have brought hurt to someone, he's saying, I want you to deal with that hurt that you've caused. I'd love to pray with you. Is there anybody that I could pray for you? If you, God is saying you've hurt and you need to make that right, and I want you to give it to the Lord. Is anybody here if I can pray for you? Okay. Yeah. See those hands? Yeah. Thank you. You can put your hands down. Lord God, I pray your anointing on each of these people, Lord, this morning, for the hurt that they have caused. Lord, that you forgive them. You're saying, give it to me. I will give you freedom. I will restore your joy. Lord, if they need to make it right, if there's a way, help them to do that. Lord, if they just needed your forgiveness and forgive themselves, Lord, then may that happen as well, Lord Jesus. And Lord, I pray, Lord, it doesn't end here this morning, but Lord God, that you would continue to talk with us. Lord, as we're walking, if you are saying, you're guiding us and saying, I want you to deal with this. There's hardness here. You've got unforgiveness here, Lord, that you would show us Lord, as we walk with you, Lord, this Holy Spirit, Lord, as we are, whatever we are doing in our homes, in our car, that you would show us and we would become more like you. And Lord God, that you would help us to walk this through. Lord God, that we would be a person of love, a person of forgiveness, a person that accepts others, Lord God, so that when we come together as a community, that this is who we will be, Lord God, and we would be our thought authentic in you. And we just thank you now, Lord God. The last thing is, if you're here and you've not given your heart to the Lord, and you've heard about Jesus, that he died for you, that he rose again for you, and that he wants to be part of your life, if you would like to invite Jesus to be a part of your life, come into your heart, which is say coming into your soul, and that the Holy Spirit wants to come and dwell in you. If you want to give your life to the Lord for the first time today, I'd love to pray with you. Is anybody here that wants to give their heart to the Lord this morning? Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. You can put your hand down. Lord God, we pray, Holy Spirit, Lord, that you would come and cleanse. Give the assurance, Lord God, that you dwell in their lives, Lord God. And Lord God, Holy Spirit, that this one would want to give everything to you, Lord God, and that you would restore them to the person you created them to be. And we just thank you, Lord. Come and dwell in them. May they feel your presence, God. We just thank you, Lord God. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Now, Lord God, we just go from this place. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, that we do not walk alone, but you go with us. Lord, we thank you for the truths in your body. Lord, we thank you in your word. Lord, we thank you. Lord, as we read your word of restoration, then this is your love story to us. Oh, Lord, that every time that we have walked away from you, Lord, that you have restored us into relationship. And Lord, I pray that for every person here, that you would restore relationships. We just thank you now in your name, Jesus. Why don't you stand? I think we will end that. We'll just end it. So I just want to say God bless you. Have a good week. I don't know what you're doing. If you're going on holidays, if you're coming back from holidays, we love you. We care for you. Have a safe time. And we'll see you next week. God bless you. Thanks, guys.